Suffering all things odorous and odious. And joining me on our olfactory odyssey are the fragrant Nish Kumar. The aromatic Sally Phillips. The musky Ross Noble. The unmistakable essence of Alan Davis! And their buzzers are particularly odorous. Sally goes...
You got to stop and smell the roses.
Oh, I love that. Nish goes...
Oh, I think I smell a rat. Oh, I think I smell a rat.
Oh, more of that. Ross goes.
I can smell it, baby. Can you smell it too?
Drinks half price. And Alan goes.
Even on a show as highbrow as this, that is still funny.
You can't. The whole show is about smell. OK, so I've got these scratch and sniff stickers and that they often give out in schools for good work. So I've got strawberry, lemon meringue and grape. And if you do good work and are particularly clever, you could have a scratch and sniff sticker.
Oh.
OK. So which would you want to go for, strawberry, lemon or grape?
I've got a cold. I can't smell anything at the moment. So really, I'm easy.
But you're lucky because you're next to Ross. It's the best.
How dare you? These pants were fresh on last week.
I don't think, Sally, can I just say, no woman should ever say, I can't smell anything, I'm easy. I don't think that's...
Nothing of your dream is a woman with no sense of smell.
OK, let's start with some smells. What scent should you wear to attract a cougar?
Ooh. Is it John Cougar Mellencamp? Yeah. If you're in a, if you're camping and you're eating some melon and a cougar appears, you hear the music of the 80s.
I've really missed you, Ross.
There's a double meaning at work.
You know me well.
You see?
Yes.
The vampy older lady.
Bonjour.
The cougar. Hi. Excellent example.
You're calling Sally old.
I'm fine with that.
Oh. You're
easy, no sense of smell.
It's a hell of a Tinder profile.
You're swiping left or right at the moment, Nish?
100% left.
I don't even know what I just asked you. Well, 2003, the Wildlife Conservation Society tested a variety of scents to see which ones big cats find attractive.
Wow.
Now, why would they do this?
Was it too busy in the perfume department of Boots?
Yeah.
Because the thing about those women, you know, in the makeup...
Yeah, they're terrifying.
They've got those faces.
I know.
And a wild cat can rip at the face and have no effect. Deep the makeup is.
No, what it is, you want to lure the big cats in towards camera traps for filming. So they discovered that there's a clear winner. Calvin Klein's obsession kept big cats interested for 11 minutes.
Wow.
Yeah. By comparison, Nina Ritchie's L'Air du Temps, 10 minutes. The effects of Revlon's Charlie, 15 and a half seconds.
And some mild blistering.
I thought they attracted wild cats with piss. Of other wild cats.
What? That's a hell of a night out.
How did you come to think this?
I thought that they made ointments of the urine of other of male.
Yeah, they do, but it's called Lynx.
So the smell matters with wild animals. In 2003, the Manitoba government, they had a terrible issue with polar bears. And the issue was there were orphaned polar bears, but the adult females did not want to adopt them because they could smell them and tell it wasn't their baby. So they put them both to sleep, and then they rubbed the baby all over with Vicks Vapor Rub. And then they put Vicks Vapor Rub on the muzzle of the female. And when she woke up, she sniffed the cub that was next to her. She thought it was her baby and she adopted it. And that was the... So I know! And they, neither of them got a cold.
So you're... When you said they put them to sleep...
Yeah, no.
So there's a scientist, injects this thing, there's a dead polar bear, and then they just tied it to the leg of the mum, and she just... I think we need to do more research on this, lads. Tying polar bears to each other.
This mother is not adopting this cub. Kill them both. Next. What about the Vicks Vapor Rub? Don't be absurd.
Right, we're going to play a game now. Time to play On the Scent. Ooh. Okay, I've got some descriptions of perfumes, and I want you to guess which celebrity they come from, okay? So, focused on the topic of decisiveness and persistence, its composition is based on sophisticated shades of spices, which are blended with citruses over a masculine, elegant heart and a woody, leathery base. Smell the
rose. Is it David Beckham?
It is! Oh!
Leathery.
Yeah. Grape, lemon or strawberry?
I'd have grape, please.
There you go.
That was amazing. That's amazing the way you did it. Do you smell that and you go, Beckham's coming?
You have to smell it. There's no point just putting it on
you. I can't smell anything, I've told you.
Oh,
I've got
scratch
a cold.
I never thought I'd say this to a woman. Just scratch it and sniff. Ross can sniff it.
Sorry, do you just want to carry on while we're doing it?
He can't smell it either.
I have a terrible smell. Look at me. Terrible sense of smell.
That's why you're at the end. So it's about, it's called Beyond Forever.
I love it.
Beyond by David Forever. Beckham. OK, here's the next one. Ready? The perfect accessory for the confident man determined to make his mark with passion, perseverance and drive. For those who aspire to create their own empire through personal achievement, this dynamic scent is both compelling and leaves a lasting impression. Bold notes of... Ross.
Is it Rory Bremner?
Rory could probably do this person, I would imagine.
Donald Trump.
Yes! Yes!
I'm very, very pleased to actually have a Trump set.
It's called Empire by Donald Trump. You wanted lemon meringue, didn't you?
Lemon meringue, yeah.
No, with sunglasses or without? There you go.
Thank
I gave you,
you
sunglasses.
So much. That's I'm going to scratch quite hard.
Right. Are you getting lemon meringue?
Quite a lot on my finger. Yeah, oh, hang on, that's not lemon. You're doing your own jokes here.
Right, last one. Are ready? Base notes are leather, peat fire, Highland mud, burned rubber and white truffle.
Smell, Laura.
Yes, Nish.
Is it Ross?
You do call me the Highland Truffle? Because of that dance I invented. Oh, yeah, dressed as a pig and in a kilt.
Have you not got your own perfume in the...
I've released many scents. but not one that people would pay for.
I quite like the idea of a perfume called Noble Gas. I think that's...
Although I have to say
that
I think a lady's perfume that had a two-stroke mix, that would just get me...
Oh, that does smell nice,
isn't
it?
That just that two-stroke mix, oil and petrol.
The stuff you put in lawnmowers.
It just, I did once see Anne Summers were releasing lager-flavoured booby drops.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
Yeah, make women smell like things that men like petrol and...
Whoa, no.
Lager.
I don't want just petrol. It's a fine adjustment. Because if she dabs a bit of two-stroke on, I think, oh, it's beautiful.
Do you want notes of two-stroke?
Yeah.
I'm going to carry on with this one. Heart notes are sharp and tempting with cigar, heather, fir and rubber. Top notes complete the fragrance with fresh spiced notes of bergamot, black pepper, pine and whiskey.
David Dickinson?
I would have to say creosote if it was David Dickinson. It's a boy.
Is it George Clooney?
No, it's the best name for a perfume ever, I think. It is Cumming by Alan Cumming. Right. Now, what will the apocalypse smell like?
Mm. Oh, well, there's four horses, so there's a start.
Yeah.
Massive barbecue.
A barbecued horse.
Kind of. What other sort of smells might you find?
Well, there's pestilence, isn't there? That's got to be...
Pestilence is very bad, isn't
it? That's going to be odorous. That's
awful. Yeah.
I can't imagine plague's going to be a barrel of laughs as
no,
well.
That's no, that's whiffy.
Well, here's the thing. There is a perfume specifically designed to smell like the apocalypse.
What?
And I have it here. Two artists, Joe Thompson and Alison Craighead, they went through the Book of Revelation in the 1611 King James Bible and they put together everything that has a recognisable smell. So it's blood, rocks of the mountains, incense, wormwood, rod of iron, creatures of the sea, hail and fire, animal horns.
Racism.
So they passed this list to an Edinburgh-based perfume maker, Ewan McCall, and he turned it into a scent. A reporter for the Guardian newspaper had a sniff and described it as digestive. What do you think it smells like?
Well, it smells of the apocalypse. It tastes of... Weirdly, it tastes of Romford.
I think it smells of Glow by Jennifer Lopez.
How do you have such an encyclopedic knowledge of all celebrities' fragrances?
Very impressive. Is it unpleasant? I haven't actually smelled it.
I can't smell anything.
It gets right to the back of your brain.
According to Anna Williams, who's the Associate Professor in Forensic Anthropology at the University of Huddersfield, the smell of death is very, very complicated. There's about 480 individual odours, and apparently death, to begin with, rather pleasant. It smells sort of freshly mown grass, that sort of thing. Leaf litter. A few days later, smells of paint thinner. It's not quite so bad. Once decomposition sets in,
oh,
we're getting towards rotting cabbage, then old fish, vomit, and eventually sweet burning rubber. So that's just taking you through the whole smell there of the thing.
That's like me after a big night out.
I went for a walk once with Caroline Quentin and we found a dead horse. And it was in a sort of a pit. And it was... Oh, actually, I think it was a donkey. And I'd know, and the stench was unbelievable.
It is. It's very high, isn't it?
Is this a real thing or is this an episode of Jonathan Crane? Are you now starting to think that scenes are real? And then we're in this windmill, right?
The thing was, we were filming Jonathan Creek and then we were having a break between scenes and we stumbled upon our own mystery.
Yeah.
I think that was probably a real-life game of Buckaroo gone wrong.
I love Buckaroo.
Not with a real donkey, you know. It's all fun and games till you put the chest on its back and then it snaps the spine. RSPCA are called. You have to drag it into a pit. It's a nightmare. And then just as you're covering it up, bloody film crew, sir.
This looks like real-life Buckaroo. I'm trying to do an impression of myself. As bad as all my other impressions. I can't even do myself.
There are dead things that smell nice. Dead saints apparently smell beautiful. The odour of sanctity, which is known as osmogenesia. Apparently, saints smell of lilies. That's one of the ways you know they're saints. Padre Pio, who was a famous Italian priest and became a saint.
Who looks exactly the same as Obi-Wan Kenobi.
He does look just like Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Here's a tip for you, right? If you're ever at a holy shrine and there's a Padre Pio there, he's got the white hair, he's got the white beard, he's got the long brown robes, and he stands like this. These are not the droids you're looking for, love. Save a fortune, half the price of a Star Wars figure at Toys R Us. Give it to your kids. Yep. Save at Christmas. You're welcome.
And smells of lilies.
Yeah.
Anyway, there you are. Now, who won the Battle of the Smellies?
I know something where you have to try and make yourself smelly. Turkish wrestling.
Oh, yes, is that the point
they
of it?
They make themselves smelly to be appalling to their opponent so they don't wash for days and they... Maybe it isn't Turkish dressing.
Are you thinking... You're thinking of fencing, mate.
No, are you thinking of Turkish delight? That's the answer.
Is it big on Sky Sports?
No.
Okay,
no, it's
not. So we're going to go to the 1950s. What happened in entertainment in the 1950s?
Television.
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 So it's smell-o-vision.
Yeah, the cinemas were worried because television was becoming so huge and they thought they needed a gimmick, and so they began to pipe smells into films. And there were two different systems. There was smell-o-vision and there was aromarama. And they both released films within a couple of weeks of each other, and it became known as the Battle of the Smellies, and neither one of them was hugely successful. So smell-o-vision was delivered by a device which was called the smell brain. It was kept under the viewer's seat, but the technology was, let's call it, imperfect. So some aromas were delivered with a bit of a delay, so they didn't match the images, which was quite bad. Other smells made people nauseous, and the delivery mechanism apparently hissed really loudly, so that interfered with people's enjoyment of the film. And then there was Aromarama, and that used the cinema's air conditioning system to deliver the smells from above, also very unpopular. There's a review in the New York Times in 1959 that said that when this viewer emerged from the theatre, he happily filled his lungs with that lovely fume-laden New York ozone. It never has smelled so good. And the American singer-songwriter Melanie, she released an album in 1972. It's called Garden in the City. And it's got, you can see down here, a scratch-and-sniff label on the cover. And the instruction said, rub gently to release the magic of Melanie's garden, you could say. I think we'll move on. Like all wars, the Battle of the Smellies resulted in no winners and only losers. Why is the second smelliest man in the world so frustrated?
Is he frustrated because everyone's like, boy, you must be the smelliest person in the world, and he's like, yeah, you'd think.
You'd think.
Do I have a certificate? No.
Is it Boris Johnson?
It's a cattle herder from India called Kailash Singh. He stopped washing in 1974 because a priest told him that he would have a son if he didn't bathe or cut his hair. So it's 40 years later, he hasn't had a single bath or a shower. He's got 6-foot-long dreadlocks. He's father to 7 daughters and no... What? Can you believe he's had sex at all? It's breathtaking. There's the lovely place of Varanasi on the banks of the Ganges there where he lives. His family did once try and force him to bathe in the river, but he fought them off and said he would rather die.
So they killed him.
Yeah. But he now says he's going to wash in the next life.
Oh.
That's his plan. But he is only the second smelliest man in the world. The person currently believed to be the most unwashed man in the world is Amul Haji. We don't have a picture of him. I think it would be too much for the camera.
The photographer can get near enough.
Use a zoom! It's James! The lens is fogging!
He hasn't washed for over 60 years. He lives, not surprisingly, in a remote village.
What he'd have to do, he'd have to be like the cheetahs. He'd have to set up a camera and then try and attract him.
Where's his village?
He lives in southern Iran and he lives on roadkill. He gets more and more attractive as you go through. He particularly likes porcupine and he smokes animal dung in his pipe. And if he needs a haircut, he burns his hair off with fire.
Hey, stop looking at me.
We've been talking a lot about smell. How do you measure the unpleasantness of a smell? How might you decide?
I mean, I don't know, but I once did a fart that was so bad, I didn't own up to it, and my dad went and got the Yellow Pages out, and he was looking for the number of a plumber because he thought a sewage pipe would leak.
Labrador you could blame.
Dogs' farts are bad.
They're very
My
bad.
Dog used to get up. The only time she ever left the room was if she'd farted. She'd be lying there by the sofa asleep, and I'd be watching Morse or something. And then she'd just get up and go in the hall, and then I'd immediately have to, I'd have to pause Morse and get up. And then we'd both have to stand in the hall for a period of time until it would clear. Then the two of us in the flat.
In a minute, here's the thing. There's a Danish engineer called Professor Paul Fanger, and he wants to create a new unit of measurement called an ulf, OK? So one ulf would be the emission of air pollutants given off by a standard person, and the idea is that any unpleasant smell could then be expressed by the number of people it would take to cause that level of unpleasantness. So you have an average person is an ulf, and then say that your fart, you know, wow, that's like 150 ulfs.
Ooh, yeah.
That it would be.
That was a lot of ulfs.
That's a lot of ulfs.
My wife, her horses, our bedroom, it's got a window, and the horses are out there, and they fart so loudly that sometimes I have to turn the telly up. On a summer's evening, just lying in bed there, put the telly on, you just hear.
They're eating, or was it?
They have
particularly...
to, or they die.
But are they particularly gassy horses?
Oh, God, yeah, horses. Oh. They're shocking. I don't know how the Queen stands it in that carriage. Unbelievable. Honestly, it's by a car.
Yeah.
That's why the hat's always at a jaunty angle.
Anyway, moving on. What do the UK's stink pipes do?
It sounds like a barbershop quartet. Isn't it? Stink pipes.
A great title for a band. Yeah.
And now the stink pipes.
It's an actual thing. Indeed, you may have passed one on the way to the studio. I think the nearest one to this studio is at Southwark Bridge.
So they're letting out odours from the sewers?
Absolutely right. Yes, you can have another sticker. You can have another sticker. Very well done. Hello. Double one. Yes, you're absolutely right. They're sort of tall, hollow cast iron pipes. They stand quite often 6 to 8 meters tall, and their purpose is to ventilate the potentially. Is it smelling?
How cheap is that?
Oh yes, that one has. Yes, that smells, doesn't it? Nick?
Yeah. That's a very strong smell.
Do they still work?
They still absolutely work, and they follow the routes of the main sewers. Lots of them are still in operation.
How cheap is that flat?
Yeah, that's not nice, is it? You do have to update sewers because sewer explosions are not uncommon if they're not properly looked after and the gas isn't released and so on. So the River Fleet at King's Cross exploded in 1846. It destroyed a Clerkenwell poorhouse and it smashed a Thames steamboat against Blackfriars Bridge.
Can we do anything with it yet? Some scientists managed to, you know, like...
With the sewage?
Create power or something.
Well, the gas, they used to burn the gas off sometimes at the top of the stink pipes. In fact, in Sheffield, you can still see that. You can see some of the gas being burnt off. But whether they could actually power things with sewage, that would be fantastic, wouldn't it?
I mean, they can use the... It's normally animal feces, but very, very popular for making houses. Wattle and daub.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, it's fantastic stuff. And in the pioneer days in the United States, when they were heading west across Nevada and places like that, there was nothing to burn. They used to burn buffalo dung. So it was used to be known as buffalo chips. So there are uses, and perhaps we're just not being sensible about it.
All I'm saying is that we've got all this sewage that isn't being used. We've got a housing crisis.
New facts.
Don't you think they're rather beautiful? And this is the thing I love about the Victorians. They made things to be beautiful, even sort of rubbish things. So the interior of Crossness Sewer Pump Station, which is in Belvedere in Kent. There it is. Look at that.
Wow.
It's known as the Cathedral on the Marsh for its ornate design and just breathtakingly beautiful. Listen, while we're speaking of beauty combined with bowels, who hasn't started a conversation like that on a hot day? I just want to show you something which is one of my favourite buildings, and it is called the Rundtårn, and it is a 17th century tower in Copenhagen. It's breathtakingly beautiful inside. It's one of the world's first observatories. There's the inside. Isn't that stunning? And it was designed so that the king could ride his horse up so that he didn't have to walk up the stairs. But what is extraordinary about it is there's a toilet at the top which consists of a seat and a shaft straight down to the bottom, and there was no way of emptying it, so it just filled up. It's one of the world's largest and earliest septic tanks. I mean, today it's got a sort of glass plate over it, so you can't smell anything. But it was point zero, used by the famous Danish astronomer Thomas Bugge in the 1760s as the starting point for his calculations for the measuring of Denmark. So he started the whole of the measuring and mapping of Denmark from that toilet seat.
I have a lot of my best ideas while I'm taking a number two. I can only imagine one day I'll be like, Denmark.
That's it. If you go, it's really beautiful. And at the very top is a kissing bench designed for couples.
How close to the toilet?
Now, whose social media is little more than an odious pile of crap?
Is that a trick question? Because isn't it everyone's?
No, it's the white rhino. They use their poo as a kind of social media. Look at that, magnificent creature. And so they did a study by the University of KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa, and they found that because they have sort of communal latrines, they have places where they all get together and have a defecation, and there are chemical clues, and you can tell the age, the sex, the general health, the reproductive condition of the other rhinos. It gives away basically their profile, how they're feeling, their relationship status. I don't think there are any videos of cats or anything like that. But through their dung, they can communicate with other rhinos. The Canadians used to have a political party actually called the Rhinoceros Party, and part of their policy proposal was to abolish the environment because it caused too much trouble. It's just annoying. They named the party after Cacerero, a black rhino who was put up as a candidate in 1958 in Sao Paulo in the elections in Brazil and won. She got 100,000 votes before her election was nullified. And there are other animals. 1954, a goat called Smelly was voted in as a city councillor in Brazil. And at the time of recording, there's a cat called Stubbs, who is still the mayor of Talkeetna, Alaska. And there he has been mayor since 1997. Right, time for a little food. I want you to smell this oil and tell me what has been added to it. There you go.
Is it truffle?
Wow.
Idiot. I'm an idiot. That's the thing with being a worldwide international restaurant critic. When I get a taste of the truffle, I can't. Yeah.
Here's the thing. Almost all truffle oil on the market has never seen a truffle. It's a mixture of olive oil and chemicals, which gives it its truffle aroma. So what you do is you take methyl mercaptan, which is the main compound in bad breath and smelly feet, and you add it to some formaldehyde. I love the smell of truffle. The Epicureans said the scent smelled like the tousled sheets on a brothel bed. And medieval monks were not allowed to have truffles because it was believed that it would make them forget their calling. I don't know, these are unbelievably expensive. We have some actual truffles there. Is it nice? Is it nice like that?
Totally wasted on me.
Do not like it, don't you?
My idea of a really nice taste is a bourbon.
We're not talking French royalty.
No, we're talking you can get a packet of 100 in Tesco's for 40p.
There's some surprising stuff in the world of food that you wouldn't know. So you wouldn't know mostly when you buy truffle oil that it has never been anywhere near a truffle. And also, can I recommend a book to you called Extra Virginity, The Sublime and Scandalous World of Olive Oil? Okay? And it turns out that there's a huge amount of fraudulent mislabeling in the olive oil world. Apparently, over 50% of olive oil sold in Italy is adulterated, and 75 to 80% in the United States is completely adulterated. You'd think you're getting that.
They should have on the extra virgin olive oil, they should have, like, in brackets, may contain slag.
Definitely. And possibly a double sticker on that one. I think there's a double. I think that was
definitely. So the truffle oil that doesn't contain the truffles.
Yeah.
If I was to take a highly trained truffle pig,
yes,
would it sniff out the truffle oil? Even though it smells a bit, it smells like a truffle, but it doesn't have truffle in. Could you check?
Yes. The exact sensitivity of a truffle pig is not my specialist area. Sally, can I just thank you for coming on and being sensitive?
I mean, once I dressed up as a wolf, right? Yeah. He's only built his house out of straw, idiot. So. So they're not.
Honestly, it feels like charity work, Simon.
So what I'm saying is, if you dipped a non-truffle in yeah. the artificial truffle oil,
yeah.
and then it would be sold as a truffle,
yeah.
and nobody, we're onto a money-making scheme.
And there, I think,
dipped a real truffle in some fake truffle smell. That's what you just said.
No, no, no. It's all about fooling pigs.
Okay.
So. So no, you get something that looks like a truffle.
Right. Mm-hmm. It's, okay.
It. Goat shit.
Okay. Goat shit. On which, if you tune in, right, yeah. and you see Gloria Hunterford on Rip Off Britain and a picture of me and a pig. Oh, yeah.
If I see a picture of you and a pig with Gloria Hunterford, I won't be the least bit surprised. Now, do you have the ability to sniff out crime?
Depends what kind of crime.
He who smelt it, dealt it. That is legally binding.
Today, I probably couldn't sniff out a crime because of the cold aforementioned. But, I mean, I guess you could smell certain types of crime.
Well, they did some research in the Karolinska Institute in Sweden, a professor, Matt Olson, and people can tell a criminal by smell as well as by sight. So they showed some video clips to people of crimes being committed and asked them to smell, at the same time, the body odor of the person who was committing it. And when there was a lineup, just by the smell of the person, they were able to work out 70% of the time, which is exactly the same as a visual lineup, they were able to work out which person it was.
If the shirt don't whiff, you must acquit.
That is the law.
I cannot wait to see the Swedish version of Sherlock, because it's just him going, smell-a-mentary, my dear Watson.
Hey, come on! Blown.
Has he got any stickers? Have you got any stickers, Nish?
He hasn't got
no, because I was going to ask for them back.
Take them back.
If the five of us committed a crime and somebody was allowed to sniff our clothes immediately, then they would be able, by sniffing, to work out again which one of us it was.
Is that where the term smell a rat comes from? I smell a rat.
No.
That's
okay. No.
But there are places, so in Alaska, Florida, New York, they use scent lineups. But to be fair, they use dogs rather than human beings because the human can smell with... We have about 5 or 6 million odour-detecting cells. A dog, how many do you reckon?
10 million.
220 million. And actually, even rabbits have more than us. They have 100 million.
Well, I don't understand about that. Is that why they don't just continually wince and cry out at the stenches that they encounter? They must be able to turn it on and off. Wow. It's a bit like owls. An owl, because it's got its concave face and can amplify sound, I think this was on QI, I learnt this, can hear a vole's heartbeat underground. But how can it not be driven mad by constant noise? I mean, if a car backfires, it'd blow its brains out.
Well, what we're going to do now is we're going to test out how a dog does on sniffing things out. I have here some contraband, which I am going to give to you, Alan.
OK.
And what I would like you to do is put it in your pocket...
Put it in my...
..and go and hide in the audience.
Go and hide in Croydon.
So the audience have got special masks to put on, so if they could put... Those who've got masks could put them on.
Oh, my God.
So it's terrifying.
Oh, it's like a sea. That's awful.
Terrifying.
Oh, yeah, because you're doing it.
Now, this is a very special episode of Jonathan Creek. I never thought I'd be involved in a live game of Where's Wally?
OK, we now welcome, please, to the studio from the RAF Police, Corporal Sam Robson Rodriguez and Rex. Sam, thank you so much for coming in and supplying us with the dummy contraband. Tell me about Rex and what his job is.
Well, Rex is a 5-year-old black lab. His main job is to search for drugs anywhere we want to put him, basically.
And how is he trained? How do you make him be able to do that?
Well, we start searching for, like, their toys, and then we just associate the toys with the drugs. So then in their head, they think they're searching for their toy, whereas in fact, we want them to search for the drugs.
And how many scents can Rex recognize, do you think?
He's trained on all the main scents and basically anything that you can make out of that.
So he looks keen to get going.
He does.
Right, Sam, please, over to you, my lovely.
Thank you very much. Rex, come
here. I do hope nobody in the audience has got anything.
I really hope somebody does.
Yeah.
That would be, wouldn't that just be the best bit of telly ever? If you just, if you dragged someone to the floor and just dragged them out.
A live drug bust on QI. Really.
So far, someone ignoring everybody. So that's good for that side. How will he show if he knows?
They have either a stand indication or a sit indication.
Oh.
Is he sniffing your crotch, Alan?
Is it in your left
oh
pocket?
Oh, my God!
Let's have a round of applause, please, for Rex and Sam. Sam and Rex, very good. Thank you very much. And thank you to all my Alans. What a very, very spooky sight that was.
That was very, very
extremely
spooky.
Unpleasant. Right, it's time for the stinking miasma that is general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. In which country was the full bikini wax invented? Sally.
I think I'm going to fall into a hole. I'm going to say Brazil. It's not right, is it?
No! Not Brazil.
Croydon.
It's not Croydon anymore.
Australia? America?
It is America. It is in the United States. So there's a woman called Jonice Padilla of Jay Sisters Salon in Manhattan. They pioneered the Brazilian bikini wax in the early 1990s, and Playboy tried to patent it as an idea. And in order to stop them doing that, she said, oh, no, no, you can't do that. It's tremendously popular throughout my entire home country, and therefore it is unpatentable.
And that is, you have to use proper wax there. Never just think you can use honey.
Speak from experience.
Oh, it stings in so many different ways.
The salon still exists and it's opposite Trump Tower. So you can actually have a Brazilian and avoid being grabbed by the pussy at the same time. They came up with the process after other salons refused to wax that area, apparently.
Oh, wow.
Apparently, one of the world's most expensive car waxes is also Brazilian. It is called Carnuba wax, made from a palm tree that only grows in northeast Brazil.
Handy if you've got a hairy car.
Yeah. You can get a French wax as well, but it only waxes a strip down the middle of the bonnet. Why should you be worried about how you store your toothbrush?
Is it to do with things that crawl around at night and crawl about your brushes?
Do you think there are things crawling about your bathroom?
Yeah, if you put your toothbrush in the wrong place, it's more susceptible to interference from
are you
creatures.
Are you worried about the wombles?
There is a common belief that if you keep your toothbrush in the same room as the toilet, it will get covered in fecal matter.
Well,
so here's the good news.
To be fair, that is true, but that's only after my wife and I had a bit of an argument. She told me 2 or 3 days later, so...
It's true that your whole house has got fecal matter, but it has no effect on you whatsoever. It's fine. According to the American Dental Association, there's insufficient clinical evidence to support that bacterial growth on toothbrushes will lead to specific adverse oral or systemic health effects.
It's good. It's good to know. Now I can use my toothbrush to just puff me downstairs.
It's really good to know you don't have to worry about creatures crawling around your toothbrush.
Really, really small cougars at night. Can you name an animal well known for playing possum?
Is this a trick question? Yeah. I've been playing this game for 15 years now. And I smell a rat!
Ah.
A possum.
Possum, a possum! Yay! It isn't...
Feigning death, right? Is that what that is?
It is. It's called thanatosis. But it isn't the possum that does it. It is the expression that we use. It is the opossum. So it's one of those great confusion...
Irish possum.
It is an opossum. An opossum. The opossum is on the right there, the little white-faced one. And the possum is on the left. They're both marsupials. The possum actually lives in Australia. The opossum lives in the United States. And apart from them both being marsupials, there's not really much that they have in common. The similarity between the name stems from Captain Cook's voyage to Australia. The naturalist Joseph Banks, he mistook the animals that he saw for American opossums.
We were in Australia when my daughter was very little. We used to go out. The only way she'd go to sleep at night is if we could go out in the street and find a possum, and then she could rest. And they used to walk along the telephone wires. That was the best place to find them.
We had possums that lived in our roof, and they used to sigh. So you'd be watching the telly, and you'd hear in the roof, you'd hear, oh. And then they do it quite a lot, and you'd be sort of like, they're off again, and then we'd, oh. There was one day, I was in the house by myself. Well, this was the thing, I was watching documentaries, and there was a,
Did they want you to change channels?
Yeah, I put it onto the music channel.
Yeah?
Not a peep out.
There are lots of animals that react to a threat. So the turkey vulture, they regurgitate their last meal, usually rotting carrion, always attractive. The king rat snake, also known as the stinking goddess, it empties its anal glands when it's attacked.
The stinking goddess?
Yeah.
That's a hell of a takeaway.
OK.
I'm going for it. I'm going to do it. I'll have a stinking goddess. Bring it on. You only have one stag night, right?
Who's got a bit of the Donald Trump look, I think, about it, can turn its anal pouch inside out. Well, it's a most extraordinary thing. Apparently, it puts off predators, but it has a calming effect on bees. I mean, that's a good thing. Honey forms a major part of their diet, but the bees go, oh, look, an anal pouch turned inside out. According to the Guinness Book of Animal Records, the smelliest animal on Earth is the zorilla, or striped polecat. This is going to love this. The emissions from their anal glands not only stink, but can temporarily blind predators and cause painful burning sensations on the skin. So that is a seriously stinky
creature. You can't get it out of your jeans.
The smell or the animal. Sorry, officer.
Just have a look at this VT, which I really love. The Caraftohelix snail. It does the complete opposite of playing possum. Have a look. Rather than retreat into its shell, it goes on the offensive. It uses its shell, look at that, as a battering ram to hit.
Oh, that's very cool.
Wonderful. Yeah. That is very cool to be able to do that. If I could swing my arse like that.
You wouldn't be wasting your time sat here, would
you? No, that's true. If you think you see a possum playing possum, then they're probably dead. So let's check it out. In first place, coming up, smelling of roses with 3 points. It's Nish. In second place with minus two, Alan. In third place with minus three, Ross. Place, stinking the place up with minus five, it's Sally! So, we like to give a prize. Taking home tonight's prize, a truly odious odour, the actual scent of the apocalypse, goes to Sally. There you go. Me to thank Sally, Ross, Nish and Alan. And I leave you with this tall tale from a toilet. Tallulah Bankhead was in a cubicle in the ladies. Do you have any toilet paper? She asked the occupant of the next stall. No, came the reply. Then do you have any Kleenex? She asked. Sorry, no, the lady said again. Then can you change a 10 for 2 5s? Thank you, good night. Thank you.